My patient, Mrs. X, a 60-year-old lady from Malleshwaram, Bengaluru, educational status 8th standard and a homemaker by occupation, came with the chief complaints of swelling in front of neck since 10 years. History of presenting illness. The patient was apparently well 10 years ago when her relatives noticed a swelling in front of her neck, about 2 into 2 centimeters in size, in serious in onset, gradually progressing to the present size of around 12 into 10 centimeters. No history of rapid increase in size of the swelling. No history suggestive of compression of surrounding structures. No history suggestive of hyperthyroidism. No history suggestive of hypothyroidism. No other swellings. No dyspnea, cough, or bone pain. Past history. No history of previous surgery. No history of long-time drug intake, no history of radiation, not a known case of diabetes, hypertension, tuberculosis, asthma, epilepsy, or any chronic conditions. Treatment history, not on any medication, no history of use of any thyroid-related medication. Allergy history, not known allergy to any substances. Personal history, appetite, normal, diet, non-vegetarian. Sleep, adequate. Bowel habits, regular. Bladder habits, regular. Addictions, none. Menstrual history, age at menarche, 12 years. Regular cycles of 28 plus minus 2 days. Age at menopause, 50 years. Family history, no history of thyroid-related disease in the family. No family history of cancers. No history of thyroid swelling in neighborhood. Summary. A 60-year-old lady, postmenopausal, came with a complaint of painless, progressive swelling in front of neck since 10 years with no features suggestive of compression of adjacent structures, hypo or hyperthyroidism features, and no features suggestive of malignancy.
Excellent. Good job, Ashmita. Okay, so
thank you, sir.
Can you stop sharing so that I'll share my screen?
Sure. Yes, sir.
All right, my screen is visible, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, first things first, I know all of you are pretty bright. You will already know how to answer. The discussion has happened n number of times on this platform or various online platforms. My intention is to try and teach you guys how to present it. All right, I know you guys are good, but I want you guys to be perfect when you're presenting a case. Because invariably when you're presenting a case, you're painting a picture in the examiner's mind. So just like basically a template as to what are the important points to be said, what can be avoided so that you don't distract the examiner away and he doesn't start asking you questions which you probably don't know the answer to. So you don't need to take them in a parallel manner. So first thing is, what are the possible thyroid swellings you're going to see? Solitary nodule of the thyroid, multinodular goiter, diffuse goiter, or goiter with cervical lymph nodes, which is more in suggestive of malignancy. And the same thing, if it's presented with features suggestive of hyperthyroidism, we invariably start calling them as toxic. So toxic solitary nodule, toxic multinodular goiter. And if it's diffuse goiter with toxicosis, we call it as Graves' disease. So on and so forth. So when it comes to history, first thing is with regards to patient demographics. Okay, first thing is when you're presenting a history, don't present it point-wise. Her occupation is this. Her age is this. For example, when you said appetite, normal. Diet, this. Sleep, adequate. Bowel and bladder, something. It sounds more like when you're talking to somebody over the telephone, dial one for this, dial two for this, like that. Avoid it. Make it sound like as if you're presenting it in a sentence. In a thyroid case, if you ask me, if I was the examiner, the only thing I'm bothered about is the age and sex of the patient. Okay, and we all know why. So I won't go into that part of it. Now, with regards to occupation, educational status, and address, none of this makes any difference to your case. Okay? I know it's given in DAS saying if occupation is this, this is risk. If education status is this, you have a higher risk or so on and so forth. Like, for example, in this case, she studied up to 8th standard. Does it have any bearing on her final diagnosis? Is it contributory? No. She's a homemaker by occupation. Is it contributory? No. So don't get into that. So otherwise the examiner will start asking you questions based on that. Okay. Now, with regards to address, if it is important, then you have to please mention, okay? When I'm saying address means endemic belt. When I say endemic belt, these are the areas where it's iodine deficient and where there is a higher chance of thyroid swelling. Like in Karnataka, Yellapur is an endemic belt. The same way all your Vindhya, the mountain ranges, Himalayas, then the Satpada range. If the patient is from that particular area, stress and tell it. Otherwise, skip. You don't have to be very precise about that particular point. Chief complaint, one single line, swelling in front of the neck. Don't say swelling in front of neck. Front of your neck, front of patient's neck. It's very confusing. Swelling in front of the neck since how many years or how many months, whatever it is. Now, when it comes to history of presenting illness, one common thing I've seen is all of you have a tendency of highlighting HOPI, past history, family history. You don't need to say that. All right. So once you finish the chief complaint, you can directly jump into the HOPI and say, this way she noticed she was apparently all right so many years back. And she's noticed the swellings, or she or her relatives have noticed the swellings in so many years. It was initially small in size. Then the progression of the swelling, whether it is gradual, sudden increase, or sometimes what happens, it's long standing for 14 years. And then 1 year, there is rapid increase in size. So if that is the case, you can always say it has been gradually increasing over the last 14 years. However, since the last 1 year, there has been a rapid increase in size. Immediately after that, please mention whether the swelling is associated with pain or fever. This is because we all know if it's pain, it's more likely to tell you whether it's an inflammatory condition such as thyroiditis or that is for fever. If it's pain, it's usually bleeding into a nodule or sometimes malignant transformation. When the swelling grows so fast that it outgrows its blood supply, there'll be areas of necrosis which can cause pain. And fever, invariably inflammatory conditions such as thyroiditis. Next, with regards to pressure effects, don't say no symptoms suggestive of compression of surrounding structures, because you're trying to tell it in the patient's words. So patient will not tell you it is compressing surrounding structures. So please mention these 4 points. Dysphagia, because it can compress the esophagus in the back. Dyspnea, again, the trachea, long-standing huge goiters can compress the trachea. Hoarseness, if it is compressing the recurrent laryngeal nerve. And stridor again, because of compression of the trachea. Next, if it is a case of hyperthyroidism, if it is, or if it's a long case, it'll always be nice if you can divide them under these headings. If it first tells symptoms suggestive of primary thyrotoxicosis, you don't have to elaborate each and every symptom, at least 4 points, because they're more or less CNS symptoms, so irritability, excitability. Then in secondary thyrotoxicosis, because it's more of cardiac symptoms, you're going to ask for dyspnea, breathlessness, orthopnea, or pedal edema. And then suggestive of hypothyroidism, it's usually all your general symptoms like increased weight, decreased appetite, constipation, cold intolerance. And then you go on to symptoms suggestive of metastasis, whether there are other similar swellings in the neck, bony swellings, or pain. So I know it looks like a lot of points, but if you look at it, it's actually very simple. The first 4 points are basically only about the swelling and its surrounding structure. So it's more or less only anatomy of the gland. Okay. First, where is the swelling? It's in front of the neck. Is there something happening inside the swelling? So tell that whether there is pain or fever. Next, what else can that swelling cause? It can cause compression on other structures. So mention that. Then go on to physiology of the swelling. Physiology of swelling, very simple. It can only be hypo or hyper. So those 2 points. And finally, what is the last stage of any swelling? It will become a cancer. So talk about metastasis. So very simple. Anatomy, physiology, symptoms suggestive of metastasis. Cover these points. You're done with your HOPI. Now, when it comes to next history, you move on to is the drug and surgical history. In drug history, only if it is present, mention it. Otherwise, just one line. Tell that patient has no history of consumption of anti-thyroid drugs. Only one line. If it is there, then specify. Now, the reason I've specified antihypertensives is very rarely, they don't give it to you in the exam, but in a clinical setting, if you are sitting across a patient and sometimes long-standing antihypertensives and all can indicate that the patient is having pheochromocytoma and these patients, and it's a component of the MEN syndrome, all right? And then The last one is increase or decrease in size with respect to drugs. Certain anti-thyroid drugs can increase the size of the swelling initially, because the swelling will become compact and enlarge and then reduce in size. So a toxic goiter can increase in size after giving anti-thyroid drugs. This is important because if you have a retrosternal goiter, first of all, the inlet is very small. On top of that, if you give them anti-thyroid drugs, the swelling can increase and it can actually compress on the surrounding structures. So you're not supposed to give anti-thyroid drugs for a patient with retrosternal goiter with thyrotoxicosis. And with regards to surgery, I'm only interested if there is any surgery that has been done in the neck, like probably a thyroglossal fistula surgery, which they have done, or a hemithyroidectomy, which they have done, and now the patient complains of swelling in the opposite side of the neck. Only if it is there, you mention, otherwise just skip it. For me, menstrual history is more important than past family and personal history. Okay, because we all know that any patient with a thyroid disorder can have menstrual irregularities. Now under this also very simple, categorize them as menstruating female and postmenopausal. If it is menstruating, at what age did she attain menarche, and whether her cycles are regular or irregular? If they're regular, you just go on to say that she has 3 days of flow for a 28-day cycle. And if it is irregular, then you say she's having oligomenorrhea or menorrhagia and explain how many days of blood flow or how many pads she's changing per day as against a 28-day cycle or a 30-day cycle. And this point is very important when you have to mention whether the patient has history of repeated miscarriages, and only for a menstruating female. Don't tell this for a postmenopausal lady. Because invariably this history of repeated miscarriages, when the patient comes, they evaluate, they find she has hyperthyroidism and they treat her then and there. They don't present you with a swelling in the neck. So if it's a postmenopausal lady, she'll never reach you. The diagnosis would have been done 20, 30 years ago and treated for it. So if it's postmenopausal, one single line, just say she's postmenopausal and whether her cycles were regular. If it's irregular, then you elaborate. Because, like for example, in this case, she is a 60-year-old lady. How will it matter to you whether she attained menarche at 12 years or whether she attained menarche at 20 or 25 or 30 years? It will not make any difference to your case. Okay? So don't go to mention menarche and all these for each and every case, because it doesn't provide any extra information. It's not a case of CA breast where we are bothered about her menstruating duration and stuff like that. Then past history, if the patient has any one of these, then mention. Otherwise, just say no history of medical comorbidities. And history of radiation, if it is there, you mention. If it is not there, don't mention. Especially in this case, a 60-year-old, what radiation history are you expecting in her? If this was a 30-year-old with history of some sort of irradiation 10 years back, then I'm interested. But for a 60-year-old, what sort of radiation are we going to give? We won't. So don't mention it. Okay, because they will ask you this question and you'll get caught. So don't go to mention it unless it is there. Then family history also, only if it's important. Like if there is history of familial cancer, mention there is history of familial cancers in the family. Father was suffering from so-and-so, mother was suffering from so-and-so, and stop. Don't go to mention no similar complaints in the family, no similar complaints in the neighborhood. How does it matter if a patient from Malleshwaram's next door patient has a swelling in the neck? Do you think it is infective or do you think it's endemic to that area? It can't be. Okay, so don't mention it. And personal history, only point you guys need to make sure is please put it in a sentence. It should be like a story format. She consumes a mixed diet. She has a good appetite. Her sleep is undisturbed and her bowel and bladder habits are regular. Don't say diet, mixed. Appetite, good. Sleep, undisturbed. Bowel, regular. Bladder, regular. Don't do that. So it's very robotic. All right. So I want you to frame it in a sentence. Now, for this same case, if I was presenting this, okay, and this is how I would have presented even as a postgraduate in surgery, I would have presented in this format. Okay. I've just put it in the slide so that it's going to help you guys. So you go on and say that I'm presenting the case of Mrs. X, a 60-year-old woman. Woman, okay, don't say lady, don't say female. It's more respectable if you call her a woman. She's a homemaker and she's from Bengaluru. She presented with chief complaints of swelling in front of the neck since 10 years. She was apparently well 10 years back when her relatives noticed a small swelling in front of her neck. It was initially small in size. However, in the last 10 years, it has gradually progressed in size and has reached its present size of approximately 12 into 10 centimeters. The swelling is not associated with pain. She has no history of dyspnea, dysphagia, hoarseness of voice or stridor. She has no symptoms suggestive of hypo or hyperthyroidism. She gives no history of other similar swellings in the neck, bone pain or cough. This is basically symptom suggestive of metastasis. So you see, in one slide, I've finished off my chief complaints and HOPI with only precise information, which is important. Then please make it a point here. I don't keep telling every time menstrual history. I don't keep telling treatment history. So with menstrual history, I'm going to say she attained menopause 10 years back. And prior to that, her cycles were regular. That ends it, because nothing else beyond this is important. She has no history of use of antithyroid drugs. There are no previous surgeries in the neck. She has no known medical comorbidities. This is your past history, and no significant family history. She consumes a mixed diet. She has good appetite. Her sleep is undisturbed, and her bowel and bladder habits are regular. All right. So I will stop sharing for now, and I will take any questions. If you have any questions, please put it up in the chat box. I'll take them. So this is meant to be a short class where it's only questions on how to present the history. If you guys have any questions, please put it up in the chat box. Otherwise, Ashmita, you can please carry on with the examination part of it.
Sure, sir. I'll continue presenting the screen then.
Yes, please.
So here are the clinical photographs of the woman.
Do you want me to share the slide? I think I have the PPT here.
So I have presented. Is it not?
Yeah, it is visible. No, you were struggling.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. No, it's fine. Yeah. So the swelling, the front view and the lateral views are attached. So should I proceed?
Yeah, please.
So the consent of the patient was taken. The examination was done under adequate lighting, exposure in sitting position in presence of an attender. Physical examination. Elderly lady, conscious, oriented to time, place and person, cooperative, moderately built, well nourished with a BMI of 23, sitting comfortably on bed at the time of examination. No pallor, icterus, generalized lymphadenopathy and clubbing. Normal hair luster. Oral cavity showed good hygiene. Upper limbs warm, no tremors. Lower limbs normal, skin normal. Pulse 78 beats per minute. Blood pressure 130 by 80 mm of mercury. Respiration 14 cycles per minute. Temperature 98.8 degree Fahrenheit. Examination of the neck. Inspection. And a single ovoid swelling size 12 into 10 into 8 centimeters in anterior neck in the thyroid region, extending from the upper border of thyroid cartilage to sternal notch and lateral borders under sternocleidomastoid. Surface was bosselated. Skin over the swelling was normal with no visible veins. Swelling moves with deglutition and lower border can be seen. On palpation, patient seated with slight flexion of neck and palpated from behind. No local rise of temperature, non-tender, size 15 into 10 into 8 centimeters, extending from upper border of thyroid cartilage superiorly to sternal notch inferiorly. Lateral extent not made out as swelling extends under the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Left, right lobe and isthmus enlarged. Surface was bosselated. Borders are well demarcated. Consistency is variable, firm over most of the areas and cystic over few areas. Multiple nodules palpated, largest being 3 into 2 centimeters on the left side. Carotid pulsation felt on both the sides. Trachea is central, lymph nodes not palpable. On auscultation, no bruit heard, in superior pole. Systemic examination. Respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds were heard. Cardiovascular system, S1, S2 heard, no murmurs. Per abdomen, soft, non-tender, bowel sounds heard. Central nervous system, no neurological deficits. Musculoskeletal system, no swelling or tenderness. Summary, lady aged 60 years presented with painless, progressive swelling in front of the neck since 10 years, clinically euthyroid with no features of compression and no comorbidities. Swelling moves with deglutition, multiple nodules of variable cystic to firm consistency noted with no features of fixity, compression of nearby structures, retrosternal extension, thyrotoxicosis, and no lymph node enlargement. Provisional diagnosis, multinodular goiter in euthyroid state and no malignancy.
Done. Excellent. Questions in the chat box, I will answer them. I just don't want to break the flow. We'll finish up the examination and I'll come back and I'll answer both your questions regarding what do you mean by normal bowel and bladder habits. Okay. So we'll go back to my presentation. Is it seen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, excellent. So the first thing is when it comes to physical examination, talk about attitude of the patient. When I say attitude, is the patient anxious or is the patient calm? Okay, and this can also be seen on their face and whether the palms are moist, sweaty, and these two are important. Okay, most of the times the habit we have is conscious, oriented to time, place, and person. How many times have you examined a patient who's not oriented to time, place, and person? Hardly none, literally zero. So you don't have to keep telling this unless it gives something extra to the examination. So keep your history short and precise so that it gives you the right amount of information. So when I say the patient is calm, I know that he is not in thyrotoxicosis, that anxiety is not there on his face. And when I say his palms are dry, that means it's not moist. He is not in thyrotoxicosis. When I say it's not, if I say it's inelastic and shriveled up, then I'm going more in favor of hypothyroidism. And in general physical examination, pulse is extremely important. You can't say it is 74 beats per minute and leave it. 74 beats per minute in the right radial artery, whether it is regular in rhythm, what is the volume? Because we all know that thyrotoxicosis can be associated with hyperdynamic circulation. So whether you have a pounding pulse or whether there is any collapsing pulse when you raise the patient's arm, if it is there, it has to be specified. Next, examination is usually under these three headings. Local examination, eye signs, and then the systemic examination. Under local examination, we all know that it's classically divided into inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation. So let's get into each of it. In local examination, please keep it in mind that you're not only examining the swelling, but also the other structures in the neck, such as the carotid, the trachea, and the cervical group of lymph nodes. So you have to mention all these four, whether it is an inspection or palpation, both the places, you have to make a mention of all these four structures. So when it comes to inspection of the swelling, you're standing in front of the patient with your eye at the level of the patient's neck. And you're going to say, talk about the site, the size, the shape, the extent, the surface, just like how it's given in DAS, but with a small twist. When I present, I usually say that there is a solitary swelling in front of the neck, which moves with deglutation. I put movement of deglutation at the very beginning because it hits the examiner and you're trying to tell the examiner what swelling this is. You don't want him to ask any other question. You're going to say that it is a solitary swelling or ovoid shaped solitary swelling in front of the neck, which moves with deglutation. And then you can go on to say it measures so and so, it extends from here to there, it has smooth surface and extra, or whatever it is, you can go on and say it later. And please make it a mention. Don't say all borders are well made out. Even if they are, please make a special mention about lower border, the swelling, because it plays a very important role because of retrosternal extension of the thyroid. We know that the thyroid can only go down and not up because of the anatomical features of the thyroid, because of the capsule of the thyroid. Okay, when you say extent, use these markers. Superiorly is the thyroid notch. We know the thyroid can't go above that. Inferiorly, the suprasternal notch. Laterally, you're going to use the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid mastoid. If it's a small swelling, if it's a large swelling and it is going behind, then use the posterior border of the sternocleidomastoid as a marker to describe the swelling. And you all have this habit of adding this line just because it's given in DAS. No dilated veins, scars or sinuses. It will completely spoil your examination because the exams are, what sort of scars are you expecting? What sinus do you expect here? Then you'll go into thyroglossal fistula. Then in that they'll ask you, is it in front of hyoid, behind hyoid? At what level will the swelling be there? If the swelling is below the thyroid notch, why are you looking for this? So it just goes into uncharted territories. If it is there, mention it, even with respect to dilated veins. If it is there, mention. Otherwise, don't. Don't even get into the business of all these saying no dilated veins, scars or sinuses. You will not get extra marks for giving extra negative information which is not there. Then when it comes to carotid, look if there are any obvious pulsations that you can see. Again, this will tell you if it's a hyperdynamic circulation and you can see the carotid pulsations very obviously. And on inspection, you're going to look for trail sign. That is, if it's a unilobar goiter, it pushes the trachea to the opposite side beneath the sternocleidomastoid. So the opposite side sternocleidomastoid becomes prominent. So if that is there, you can say there is trail sign seen on the right side, which indicates that the trachea has deviated to the right. And if there are any obvious enlarged cervical lymph nodes, you can say that there is another swelling noted in this part of the neck. Otherwise, you can say there are no obviously visible swellings in the neck. Now, again, in palpation, I repeat, you have to finish mentioning about all four. In palpation, this is done standing behind the patient. It can also be done in front of the patient, but we'll not get into that because classic teaching for students is that you're supposed to palpate standing behind the patient. First point, non-tender, very straightforward. Please don't say no local rise of temperature, because next question I'll ask you is, which thyroid swelling do you expect with local rise of temperature? Okay, don't mention that. Only say it is non-tender, swelling moves with deglutation. The same thing, there's a non-tender ovoid or a solitary swelling in front of the neck which moves with deglutation. So this will be a first sentence even in palpation. Then rest of it, and the last point will be consistency. Please remember, it is just common sense. For example, if it's a tender swelling and you talk about consistency in the very beginning, the patient will, if you keep on pressing the or check consistency in the very beginning before measuring, the patient will be reluctant to let you complete the rest of the examination, like measuring and seeing the extent, movement and all. So keep that in mind. So the consistency, because it can be painful, it should be done only in the last. And these special methods or techniques, that is a Pizzolo's technique where you ask the patient to interclasp their fingers and push the neck out, only if you can't see the swelling. Now, in this case, the swelling is very obvious, so Pizzolo's is out. And in Lahis and Kreil's is if you are suspecting a nodular goiter, but on initial examination or your initial palpation, it looks smooth, like a smooth surface, only then you do the Lahi and the Kreil's method. We'll not go into the depths of it. Next is the Cocker's test, where you press on both lobes of the thyroid to see if the patient has stridor. Never to be done, because stridor is a medical emergency where you'll have to intubate the patient. So do not do it in the ward. You're not getting any extra information by doing that. And when it comes to rest of the neck, if there is carotid pulsation, whether it's present or absent, that's all. Don't say it is feeble, shifted posteriorly. No, if it is shifted posteriorly, you can't palpate it. It's as simple as that. Carotid can be palpated only at the transversus process of the C6 vertebra. So if it's shifted posteriorly or shifted laterally, there is nothing behind where you can palpate the carotid artery against. So whether you can palpate it, if you can palpate it where, or else carotid artery pulsations are absent. Next, about trachea, whether it is central or deviated, you know how to examine the trachea. You keep two fingers on either side of the suprasternal notch and run your finger down the tracheal rings. And then examination of the lymph nodes. Examine all levels from level 1 to level 5, which is the posterior triangle. Next, coming to percussion and auscultation. Percussion, all of you are taught to do a sternal percussion. Now, there are few examiners who believe that percussing over a bone is going to be dull. So according to them, you shouldn't do this test. So you have to be careful. Certain examiners want you to say it is resonant and certain examiners don't expect you to say it. So you'll have to be careful on this one point, but my suggestion will be is mention it. If they say why you did it, keep your mouth shut and just say, sorry, sir, and go ahead. That's all. Don't develop too much or try to defend your answer there. Then when it comes to auscultation, you're going to look for groovy at the upper pole of the thyroid. Again, you're going to look for signs of thyrotoxicosis. And if you have very big swelling in front of the neck, you can't make out the position of the trachea, then you're going to auscultate for the position of the trachea and you're going to listen to tracheal breath sounds. And in the last, you're going to come to eye signs. Avoid mentioning this in the starting because you still haven't told the examiner what swelling it is. So once you finish the swelling, then talk about eye signs. If it is there, you say that this patient has exophthalmosis, whether it's unilateral, bilateral, and if a few signs like Stellwags, Von Grief, Geoffroy's, Mobius, I'm sure you all know what each of these are, so we'll not get into the details of it. And finally, when it comes to systemic examination, very few important points. In CVS, just don't say no murmurs. You have to say no systolic murmurs because in hyperdynamic circulation, you're going to have systolic murmurs. So the examiner should know that you know what you're looking for. You're not just doing a routine examination like a clerk. You're a doctor who's trying to extract every ounce of information from each examination that you do. And in respiratory system, if there is a heart failure, again, in thyrotoxicosis, the patient can have overloading of the lungs and the patient can have Krebs. And in CNS, in primary thyrotoxicosis, they can have exaggerated reflexes in the knee or in the ankle. So only mention there are no exaggerated reflexes. Don't say no focal neurological deficits. We are not examining a case of a stroke or a CVA. We're examining a case of thyroid. So only specific points related to thyroid have to be mentioned. So if I was presenting this case, this was how I would have presented this, the examination part of it. Here is a 60-year-old female who's calm, who's not anxious. Her palms are dry and there are no tremors. There is no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, or clubbing. I will be describing about the examination of the lymph nodes and the eye signs at the end of local examination. Her pulse is 78 beats per minute in the right radial artery. It has good volume and regular rhythm. Her blood pressure is 130 over 70 millimeters of mercury in the right arm in sitting position, and her respiratory rate is 16 cycles per minute. On inspection, there is a single swelling in front of the neck, extending both sides laterally, and it moves with deglutition. So I'm very particular about saying it moves with deglutition in the beginning itself. It measures 12 into 10 centimeters and is ovoid in shape. It extends superiorly from the thyroid notch and inferiorly just up to the suprasternal notch. And laterally, it extends from the posterior border of one sternocleidomastoid to the posterior border of the other sternocleidomastoid. The lower border is well made out. The surface of the swelling appears bosselated because it's still in inspection. I still haven't put my hand on it, but it appears bosselated when I look at it. Now come to the rest of the neck. There are no other swellings in the neck, no obvious pulsations visible, and the trachea appears to be central in position. So I've finished inspection of the neck in one slide, okay, giving maximum information about it. Next, when it comes to palpation, there is a non-tender, solitary or single swelling in front of the neck, extending both sides laterally, and it moves with deglutation. Then the rest of it, it measures 12 into 10 centimeters, it's ovoid in shape, and the extent from where to where. And here, again, you're going to mention all borders are well made out, including the lower border. This has to be specified. Lower border has to be specified. It is extremely important. Now, the surface is bosselated with the largest nodule measuring 3 into 2 centimeters. And consistency should be the last point. It has variable consistency ranging from firm to soft in certain areas. Now come to the rest of the neck. Please mention there are no palpable cervical lymph nodes in the neck. That is what you're looking for. Don't say there are no similar swellings in the neck. No, you are examining for palpable cervical lymphadenopathy. If it is there, please describe it. Otherwise, don't. The carotid artery is palpable bilaterally and where you're palpated. That is at the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid at the level of the thyroid notch, and the trachea is central in position. There is no audible bruit or palpable thrill at the upper part or at the upper pole of the swelling on both the sides. There was a resonant note heard on direct percussion over the sternum. have put this star, star, star because certain examiners might object. If they object, say, sorry, sir, and go ahead. Because this is how we were taught. That's why I said that. I apologize for it and skip. She did not have any exophthalmosis and no eye signs of thyrotoxicosis. On systemic examination, there was no evidence of systolic murmurs. There were no Krebs on respiratory system examination, and she had no exaggerated reflexes on examination of the central nervous system. So this is a case of a multinodular goiter involving both lobes of the thyroid in a clinically euthyroid state. So this would be how I would have presented this question. So if you guys want the PPT, just please leave me a mail. This is my email ID, lkanta.57@gmail.com. I will send you the PPT for your benefit. And I'll also put it up on the chat box, my email ID, and you can ask me those questions. So you guys can start typing your questions in the chat box if you have any. And meanwhile, I will start answering. The first question you've asked is, what is normal bowel and bladder movement? Bowel habits are described as normal if a patient has up to 3 bowel movements in a day and up to 3 bowel movements in a week. Anything less than that or more than that is considered abnormal. If anything more than that is called increased frequency of stools, anything less than that is considered as constipation. Now, why are we bothered about this in thyroid examination? Because we know that hyperthyroidism can cause diarrhea. And hypothyroidism can cause constipation. That's the reason we are very particular about bowel and bladder habits. And with regards to sleep, a patient having hyperthyroidism will invariably be, will have irritability, excitability, and insomnia, where there is lack of sleep. So if there is lack of sleep, you need to mention, otherwise you say the sleep is undisturbed. And again, normal appetite. Patients having thyrotoxicosis will have an increased appetite, because they're hungry all the time because their BMR or the basal metabolic rate is so high. Whereas a patient with hypothyroidism, because of the low basal metabolic rate, although their appetite is low, but they tend to put on weight. Okay, so in hyperthyroidism, increased appetite, but there is maintaining of weight or loss of weight. In hypothyroidism, there is a decreased appetite, but there is increased or weight gain. Okay, so that is what are the important points. Any other questions? Is someone still there? Or is everyone? Okay, I will put up my email ID as well. It's lkanta.57. Okay, it stands for Lakshmi Kanta. Okay, lkanta.57@gmail.com. Okay, one second. Let me just get the chat box out. Pop out. Okay. Okay, sir, I understood about, wait, before that, there is concept of rapid increase in size and sudden increase in size. Okay. It basically means that either there are two things, there is hemorrhage into the nodule, or there is malignant transformation, all right? So that's all you need to know, okay? And when you're presenting it, you just have to say that the patient presented with a swelling in front of the neck since 2 years and there is rapid increase over the last 24 hours. That basically tells you there is hemorrhage. If there is rapid increase over a month, then it tells you it is more of a malignant transformation. So that's all you need to know about it. Irradiation history, very, very rare nowadays, but if a patient has had lymphoma, okay, they give what we call as mantle radiation, where there is radiation given to the neck. So that time, these people are exposed to risk of developing papillary carcinoma of the thyroid 10 or 15 years down the line. And invariably, lymphoma is a diagnosis which is made in the childhood. Okay, now childhood or early teens or early adulthood. Now a 60-year-old female presenting with a lymphoma at the age of 50 is extremely rare. That's the reason I told you, don't mention about radiation history unless it is absolutely important. Sir, I understood about appetite and sleep in hyper or hypo, but generally, what is the normal? Very difficult to say because they're very subjective. If a patient is able to sleep comfortably undisturbed for about 6 hours in the night, we consider that normal. And appetite is whether they're having 3 meals in a day. If they say, no, I earlier used to eat so much, now I've reduced it to so much, then that is decreased appetite. Then Ashmita Jain, apart from radiotherapy, I think this is with regard to irradiation, you have to completely skip it nowadays. Even your CT, X-ray and all do not produce radiation, which is enough to cause papillary carcinoma of the thyroid. So we don't even talk about anything else apart from radiotherapy. All this radiotherapy for tuberculosis and all is a diagnosis of the past. Then why lower border is so important to mention separately? Because in thyroid, because they can have retrosternal extension, they can have a retrosternal goiter. So lower border is very important, because we know upper border it can't go, because the anterior and the posterior lamina of the thyroid capsule get attached to the oblique line of thyroid cartilage. And it's a very dense fascia, so the swelling can't go above that, but it can go beneath that, and it can cause hoarseness, stridor, dilated veins. It can cause that SVC syndrome. That's why we are more bothered about lower border than any other border. Sir, dyspnea is due to recurrent laryngeal nerve infiltration or trachea. Please keep it in mind, infiltration is extremely rare, and it is the last stage of thyroid cancer that is seen in anaplastic carcinoma. Otherwise, thyroid malignancies are usually well differentiated. They don't pierce through the capsule. So it's more or less an enlarged thyroid swelling can cause compression both on the trachea and cause compression on the recurrent laryngeal nerve, causing dyspnea both. Or in hyperthyroidism, they can have chest congestion because of the heart failure. Even that can cause dyspnea. Or in follicular carcinoma of thyroid, they can have, there is some disturbance. Okay. Sorry, where is my chat box? Yeah. So in malignancy or metastasis, they can still have lesions in the lung that can cause dyspnea. Okay. Then, okay, sir. Thank you. Is dysphagia an important history? Yes, you can. It is important, and you need to mention it because it's a part of the compression symptoms of the thyroid.
So there are a couple of questions on the YouTube. May I ask?
Yes, please. Go ahead.
Okay, so the first question is, you have already thrown light on this topic, the importance of eye examination in a case of the neck swelling.
Yes, that is, like I told you, it's regarding the signs of thyrotoxicosis. There is a lot of disturbance. I don't know, is it my mic or... Okay. Okay, Ashmita, I will mute you. I think there is something wrong with your mic, and I will unmute you when you're about to ask the question. So with regards to eye signs, we know that in thyrotoxicosis, you can have exophthalmosis and those various signs. If it is there, you have to mention, but I mention it at the end of your local examination. Next question. Is that all?
Sir, did you not hear me? Should I repeat?
I only got the eye signs. After that, I didn't hear you.
Okay, okay. So the next question that I read out was, should we perform a transillumination test here to rule out cystic swelling?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Don't even think about it. Because thyroid is not a purely cystic swelling. It is a very rarely you can have variable consistency. And there is something called thyroid paradox. Usually the cystic swellings are firm in consistency. So if you say I'm going to do transillumination for a firm swelling, you're in trouble. And because it's a fleshy gland, sometimes a normal thyroid itself can appear cystic in consistency because it's very fleshy. So don't talk about transillumination or fluctuation test in a thyroid swelling. That's completely off. Akash has asked, dyspnea, compression symptoms of secondary thyrotoxicosis? It can be both. It can be both. But it applies to your particular case. If they ask you what are all the possibilities, you can go on listing them, 1, 2, 3, 4, so on and so forth.